Welcome to Jung Tuition. I am Jung. Let's continue discussing basic issues in weather and climate research. Today, I'm going to expose another incurable defect in trend burst energy flow diagram called the perpetual energy circulation. I'm delighted by a comment from the viewer Steve, who wrote, "The greenhouse gases cannot emit back down until Earth's surface has already emitted." Indeed, this idea could kill trend burst 40 years unintelligible diagram too. Are you ready? Let's go and have fun. The original idea to introduce the greenhouse effect hypothesis is to heat up the surface of Earth from 255 Kelvin to the current 288 Kelvin by means of so-called back radiation from the greenhouse gases to the surface. Therefore, one could expect such a back radiation would eventually be zero once the surface temperature has reached to 288 Kelvin, simply because there is no reason to keep heating up the surface all the time, just as you would stop accelerating your car in the freeway once the speed reached to, say, 100 km per hour. Still, trend bursts and many inferential climate researchers deny this common sense by insisting the back radiation should be there forever. Otherwise, the surface temperature would drop to 255 Kelvin. In this latest trend burst Earth Energy Imbalance Diagram, or EEI, the downward or back radiation is as high as 343 watt per meter square, 3 watt per meter square stronger than the sun at the top of the atmosphere, 340 watt per meter square. I'm glad to see many viewers have noticed this absurdity. To help you to understand such a non-physics idea, I have been trying to illustrate what is terribly wrong graphically based on the trend burst diagram. As you can see, I have added some detailed cash flows inside his greenhouse. First, I need to work out the net surface radiation that is absorbed by the greenhouse gases. The easiest way is to look at the lower boundary of the greenhouse. Here it is, just 36 or 378 minus 343. This implies that only 92% of his hypothetical surface radiation, 390, is required to maintain the surface temperature at 288 Kelvin. Where does the rest of his surface radiation go? Good point. Here, I have redrawn his agony diagram to make the cash flows continuously visible. In doing so, I'm going to separate the long wave cash flows between the greenhouse and the surface into two equivalent parts, namely a vertical pipe and a rectangular loop. It should be pointed out that the cash flow inside the rectangular loop forms an independent perpetual energy circulation, which can be omitted as far as budgeting his EEI diagram is concerned. In fact, one can arbitrarily use any numbers other than 343. Why? Because one can rewrite zero algebraically as n minus n, where n can be any number. To support the wrong assumption, I call it imagination, namely the surface must emit 390 all the time. Trend burst was obliged to choose 343 watt per meter square for his back radiation. So did many others. Yet, what is the driving force that makes such a perpetual energy circulation in this rectangular loop? It looks similar to an atmospheric convection between a hot surface and a cold tropopause. But the air current is made of particles with mass, and the downwinding air current is driven by gravity. More importantly, the back radiation is forbidden by the second law of thermodynamics, as many people have pointed out. Energy cannot spontaneously move from the cold greenhouse to the warm surface unless work is done externally, just as how an air conditioner works. So far, I have strictly based on the numbers he used, although these numbers are by no means accurate or meaningful, as just discussed above. Still, one can evaluate his numbers for the cash flows near the surface in relation to feasible physical processes. It is noted that the solar radiation intensity for heating up the surface is 160, which implies that the current surface temperature will be stable, provided the same intensity of cooling mechanism is available. Last year, I proposed that the surface thermal radiation should be close to zero rather than 390, because the atmosphere and the condensed matter surface have the same temperature at their interface. Otherwise, the mean surface temperature wouldn't have been so stable, less than 0.2 Kelvin fluctuation in 10 years. If so, the non-radiative cooling contribution, convection and advection in particular, should be 160, or 58 higher than what has been estimated by Trendbers and others, which is not impossible, as convection can easily beat up the thermal radiation as the pressure increases. In essence, it is conceptually incorrect to treat the real condensed matter surface of Earth as an isolated black body in vacuum. The origin of this misconception can be found in Arrhenius' paper published in 1896, but it has become more obscure since the Schwarzschild radiation transfer equation and Kirchhoff's law for radiation were used. I will discuss this issue for the first time next year. By reading his autobiography, I learned Trendbers was majored in mathematics and applied physics during his 3 years undergraduate studies, which seems in general too brief to understand so many important concepts and ideas in physics. Besides, as he admitted, he hated doing instrumental measurements, so it seems not surprising that he had no idea about convection can take over thermal radiation as shown in any perennial vacuum gauge whenever the air pressure is a fraction of the atmospheric pressure at sea level, or 1% to be exact. By the way, I often use a perennial vacuum gauge in my low temperature or liquid helium temperature experiment in my electron spin resonance research in 1990s. Although his PhD supervisor was world-renowned Dr. Lawrence, he received no feedback of his thesis draft from the creator of the Lorentz attractor or the butterfly effect. Very strange indeed. Quote, "Our monthly conversation were brief. Ed did not provide advice for my thesis and never changed a word that I wrote," unquote. I guess perhaps Lorentz was too preoccupied by creating his another important paper then, entitled Protectability of the Flow Which Possesses Many Scales of Motion. Or probably, or even possibly, Trendbers did not make enough original discoveries to impress Lorentz because he was obliged to participate in too many anti-war and women's rights activities with his girlfriend then. Thank you for watching. Thank you for making comments. Thank you for support. Thank you, Steve. See you next time.